Good evening. I am very happy to see that Dems are working hard to push that friend from across the aisle off his pedestal. And my question tonight has to do with the fact that I, as a woman, despite my skill sets, my experience, can get paid 60 cents to a man's dollar simply for the fact that I am a woman. And in other states, I might be lucky and get maybe 70 or even close, possibly close to 80 cents. I'd like to hear what you guys would do if given the opportunity to represent us in Congress about equal pay for equal work.
That's a very good question. And certainly in any contracts or any work, any union work, things of that nature, it's equal pay for equal work. That can be done. Now, I thought about the issue because I think it used to be 60. Back when the ERA, we were trying to pass the ERA, it was 62 cents. What's that? Is that the 70?
It depends on the state.
Depends on the state. Now, I thought about this, and very frankly, I wish I had a good answer. Because the fact is, if I own a private business, or this gentleman and I own a private business, and we're hiring folks, and we have, for whatever reason, we have this notion that women ought to get paid less. And we tell you guys when you work for us, you talk about the wages, there's the door. It's confidential. Respect everybody's confidentiality on their wages. You don't talk. And then later on you find out, somehow you find out that this gentleman's getting paid $80,000 a year, and this young lady's getting paid $40,000 in the same job. Now, I mean you can strengthen laws that when this is uncovered and found, you can have pretty strict penalties and fines to combat it. I think changing, it's just, and I think our culture is changing in terms of the, when you have the minority overlay, it's even worse, because unfortunately the system still has a pretty healthy dose of exploitation in terms of employment, wages. But I think you can pass laws and you can get somehow and encourage people to find it, to ferret out where there's injustice or inequity. But I think there's just my own opinion, and I may be 100% wrong, there is a percentage that it's going to be very hard to figure that out, to find out who's doing that in the private sector. I mean, clearly, what's done with immigrants, folks that are here undocumented. I worked out in Texas for a while. We call it a chamber of commerce, they have another name for it. And this woman was bragging and telling me how wonderful their huge dairy farms. I mean huge. Not like you think of farms bigger on there, thousands of cows running around the dairy farms. And I worked at the hospital where these folks that were being exploited, paying cash under the table, would come in for health care. No information about it. We retrieved them in our emergency room. I thought, yeah, there are great people, but look at what they're doing exploiting these people that come to work for them. Texas is a whole different world. That's a long conversation. But I learned and saw up there, fortunately, we don't have too much of it. We have less of the earth, I think, than out there. It's a challenging issue that we have to keep working at and see that number go up more and more.
I'm sure all three of us on the stage agree that equal work, equal pay. Okay, so I don't think any of us are going to disagree with that. That's something we all advocate for, we all believe in. I'm pretty confident that we all share the same beliefs. But so what we do about it, essentially we talk about collective bargaining already to make sure we keep collective bargaining law strong. And essentially there are two commissions in Washington, D.C. that have jurisdiction over these issues. Those are National Labor Relations Board and EEOC, Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. President Trump has continued to grow the powers of those two commissions, those two organizations. We have to make sure that we build those organizations so they can do their job. Okay, so the EEOC, we're now going to primarily that has a jurisdiction to make sure to enforce those kind of violations when they occur. So we want to make sure that they can have the ability to do their jobs. Again, EEOC, the National Information Board, we need to strengthen. Ironically, you look at public education, this problem doesn't exist in public education, it exists in the private sector more often. And I always hear folks say, this school should be running businesses. And, you know, I say businesses should be running schools. You stop and think about it. It's a whole different dynamic. But that's a conversation for another day.
So, of course, as a woman, you can imagine that I'm in favor of equal pay for equal work. But I see the problem slightly differently because I think it comes from hiring practices. And I think that we've seen many examples of that recently at Google, right, at hedge firms out in Silicon Valley that have been highlighted in the news recently, where folks are being treated differently because hiring practices are not equitable. And that comes from a lack of auditing of systems within corporations. It also isn't a smart economic decision overall for these companies. And it's not smart for the growth, the economic growth of America. Because when we only allow certain people to have certain jobs and prioritize those people and they're paying more than others, we see very quickly that we're not taking advantage of the entire pool of people. And I don't think that you have to see too many movies like the one that came out last year with the African-American women who worked at NASA in the 1960s to understand that story. But if you haven't seen that movie, I highly recommend it because it's a really good one to help understand this issue and how our country is held back when we don't pay equal pay for equal work and when we don't